We're looking to the God in heaven who knows us and loves us and cares for us. And Father, we recognize that you're able to do everything. There is nothing that's impossible for our daddy. And Father, we're asking that you would give us faith to believe for ourselves. Most of us, it's easier to believe for others than it is for ourselves. And so Father, as that man years ago that met Jesus and he said, help my unbelief. And Daddy, would you rid this room of unbelief? Would you rid our thoughts of unbelief? Would you rid our experiences of all the times that we've tried to do something or tried to respond to you in whatever way and it didn't seem like anything happened? And Daddy, we're asking that tonight there would be faith rising up in us, that there would be an expectation of the Holy Spirit. And Daddy, we're asking for you to come tonight and to be with us and meet with your people. And folks, the Bible says that God dwells right in the middle of people who are worshiping. Did you know that? Those of you standing still, not worshiping, you need to look over to the side and see where God's dwelling, because he says he dwells with worshipers. So can I get you to be a worshiper tonight? Would that be all right? There is lots of room up at the front, so if you'd like to come on up to the front and just worship the Lord, you're welcome to do that. If you like banners and streamers and things like that, we've got a large area underneath the flags for you just to enjoy yourself in the presence of God. But if you'd like to come to the front, come on up. Aaron, let's go.
I know I can trust you. in your love. darkness in the light, when I'm starving for the light, I know I can trust in your love. When I'm dry and thirsty, Lord, and I'm crying out for more, I know I can trust in your love. In the darkness, in the night, when I'm starving for the light, I know I can trust in your love. Lost, but now I'm alive.
voice and sing, I found.
I found a love greater than life itself. I found a hope stronger and nothing compares. I once was lost, but now I'm alive in you.
The just feeling, we just need a little bit of a drum right now. So we're just going to drum right now, and I just want to bless you to be free, just to move with the movement of the drums. It's very prophetic right now.
Before you sit down, how about you turn around and give five people a high five and find out where they're from. Where are you from? Welcome everybody that's watching on Catch Fire TV tonight. Glad that you're with us. We're expecting to have a great night tonight. The Holy Spirit is already here. His presence is here. It's going to be good. Wherever God is, it's always good. Well, when you can head back to your chair. You can stop. Thank you, Brando. Well, good evening, everybody. Glad that you're here. How many of you do not normally attend one of the Catch the Fire campuses? Can I get you to put your hand up? Don't normally attend the Catch the Fire campus. Great. Well, there's a whole bunch of you. Well, we're glad you're here. You will find most of us well-behaved. Most of us. Most of the time, most of us are well-behaved. So that's good. We're glad that you're here. And for those of you that are newcomers, if you would like to, you're not obligated to do this, but there's a welcome card on the chair right in front of you, or one of the chairs close to you. And if you wanted to fill that in and just let us know anything that you'd like to know about our church, or if we can help you in some way, when the offering buckets are passed a little bit later on, you can just plop that in there, and it'll be our pleasure to connect with you just a little bit more. Sandra, what do you want to say?
Welcome, everybody. It's so nice to see you. You know what? I find it very interesting, but how many people are expecting something? Yeah. So isn't it great to come to church and, like, you can, it's funny because sometimes on a Friday night, you know, we're like trying to pull you in. Oh, please, we're begging you. And like, you all came expectant. So congratulations. Pop your hands. We're just really thrilled to have you and just want to welcome you. And I don't know what he wants to do, but I'm just going to let him go.
Sorry? I wasn't paying attention.
I was just talking about how good looking you were. Daphne.
No, I don't.
Daphne Clark, my husband, is better looking than yours. Yeah, she's waving. Yeah.
Anyways.
Yeah, I know. It's a joke. It's true, though.
Where is Sandra? We're just moving on. We've been married 30 years. Yay! Do you want to talk about your new ring? No? Okay. All right. She won't talk about that. If you each pay $1 to look at it, I can maybe pay it off.
said,
what do I need to say? Where is my Greek friend that was talking to me at the door? Where are you? Where's... Every Greek man is named Nick. Nick, where are you? Where is he? Anyways, Nick was telling me at the door, as he was coming in tonight, that two Sundays ago, remember we had a healing time a couple Sundays ago, Pastor John was leading that and pushing in and pressing in, and Nick has had problems with his eyes and with reading, and he went home, and he is absolutely able to see, so I was going to get him just to share that. So we'll get that for another time then. So I don't know where he's gone. He's probably gone to Mr. Greek. That's probably it. Just gone to get some food. And Joyce, what's your dad's name? Al. Al, are you able to stand up, Al? Al's in the, if you can stand, this gentleman right here is 92 years of age. And his daughter was telling me that 41 years ago, he was at a Catherine Kuhlman meeting and was healed of cancer. Is that right? Yep. That's good. I like that kind of story, don't you? So what about you? Is your God big enough to help you? So here's my little story. We have James Maloney with us tonight. I've never heard you speak before, James. How many people have heard James Maloney speak before? Hands up. Okay, so James, there's only like 20 people here have heard you before, so that means all your good stories on tonight. So I started reading James's book this afternoon, maybe around 3:30 or so, and just trying to get to know what he's like and those kind of things, and some amazing stories in here, some really good explanation for how things work in the spirit realm, that kind of stuff. And there's a new chapter around page 95-ish, somewhere like that, and it's the story of a cross-eyed boy who's maybe 10 years of age that's healed in a church that's almost all seniors. And the pastor says you have to be finished at 10 after 12 or something like that because all the seniors start leaving to get to the restaurant before everyone else gets out of church kind of thing. And so it doesn't matter what you're doing, they're still going to leave. And sure enough, they start leaving while he's preaching in their walkers and canes and da-da-da-da. And this little boy came up to the front and the cross-eyed, and anyways, James ministers to him, the kid's healed. James yells at all the seniors, stop! Where are you going? Look what just happened. And they all came back and all sorts of healings took place. So anyways, I think you said in there that walkers are in the air, canes are flying through the air. It's like, oh my goodness. Anyways, as I'm reading that, let me back up. Wednesday, Thursday, we had all the carpets cleaned in our house. Our son and daughter-in-law who live with us are on a week's vacation, so this would be a good time to clean everything. And so we slept in a different bedroom because our room has carpet on, it was all wet. So we were in the guest room, and in the middle of the night, I usually have to go to the bathroom and just make sure all the appliances work and all that kind of stuff. And I wasn't thinking, and the height level of that bed is like a foot lower than our bed, and I twisted my back in the middle of the night getting out of bed, and the last 3 days I've had pulled muscles in my back. So as I'm reading, I'm sitting in my couch reading this and moving around different positions, sitting, lying, trying to get a comfortable position. And as I'm reading that story, on page 112, I get a disruptive thought. The disruptive thought is this. You should close that book, put it on your back, and be healed. So what would you do? So I checked what page I was on, page 112, put it behind me, sat on it, and instantly all the pain went. Yay! So this is a good book to get. This is an anointed book, and this particularly is an anointed book. So who has muscle pain right now in your body? Could you please stand? No, we're not giving you the book. We're praying for you. Praying for you. This is James's book. I borrowed it from him. So he can give it to you. If you have muscle pain of any sort, just put your hand up. Or no, stand up. That's it. Stand up. Those of you around them, just... if there's someone beside you, just tell them, is it your back? Is it your leg? Is it your... Where's the muscle pain? Just tell your friend so they can put their hands on your body. So just become a best friend with someone. Put your hand where the pain is. And Holy Spirit, we're asking for the anointing of the Holy Spirit. That's what it is, friends. It's the anointing. And if you remember, Jesus said this very clearly. He didn't do miracles. It was the anointing of the Holy Spirit that did the miracles. And the same Holy Spirit is able to be on the pages of a book, to be able to be, you can watch on a video, watch on a TV, and receive your healing, because it's the Holy Spirit, it's the anointing. And so Holy Spirit, we bless every person that is standing right now. Bless those of you that are watching right now on Revive TV. And Father, we're asking every person that has pulled muscles or any kind of strain in their muscles, we speak peace to those right now in Jesus' name, right now. And the Holy Spirit comes and just eases your discomfort so that you're able to sit through this meeting, whether it's another 2 hours or whatever the length it is. Father, we're asking that as they sit tonight, there would be no discomfort. They would find themselves completely healed. And we're asking this in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Now, twist. Check yourself. Tell your friend how their prayer did. Check yourself. Who's feeling a little bit better already? Hands up, a little bit better. Keep your hand up. Look around. There's all sorts of hands up. Yay! Woohoo! All righty. That's the appetizer for tonight. That's the appetizer.
You go. Okay, how about we do this? How about we face the camera right now? Everybody just sort of stand up and face the camera. You know, there are people watching on Revive TV right now that are in bed. Shirley, hi Shirley. We're so glad that you're watching. There's some that that are sick, that cannot be here tonight because of illness. And we want to pray. So let's just stretch our hands to them right now, because we want to believe and agree for you that are watching right now. Hi, my mom and dad, and we're praying for you too. But Father, I'm asking that you would just come right now. Father, and I'm praying for your healing to come on those ones that are watching right now. And Father, I'm praying for Shirley right now, Father, that she's sitting in her chair right now, and she's watching, she's believing and receiving her miracle right now in the name of Jesus Christ. And Father, I'm asking that you would just come and just pour strength into her body, Father. I'm praying, Father, that you would just come and do whatever you need to do, Father. I'm asking for creative miracles for people that are watching right now, Father. I'm asking that you would just come and do miracles, and that your Holy Spirit would just come and land on them right now in the name of Jesus. And everybody agreed and said, amen. Bless you.
Amen. You may be seated again. If you have your Bible, I'd like you to turn to 2 Kings 4. And there's some really good stories about two ladies in this chapter. And it begins in chapter 4, verse 1, saying there was a wife of a man who was one of the prophets. And her husband has died. And it would appear that while he was a prophet, he got himself in debt. And after he's died, the creditors come to the house and ask for the money. And she's in trouble. She goes to the head prophet, which is Elisha, and he says to her in verse 2, how can I help you? Tell me what you have in your house. And if you look in verse 3 or verse 2, this lady says, your servant has nothing there at all except, what does she have? A little bit of oil. Can I just sort of go off the topic and just say, if you have a little bit of the Holy Spirit, you're loaded. You're ready to go if you got a little bit of the Holy Spirit. So she goes around to her neighbors and borrows all the jars, the empty jars. And you remember how a great miracle takes place. And then Elisha says, go and sell the oil. Who would she be selling those oil pots to, those jars? Probably to the very person that she borrowed them from. Correct? And so one of the interesting principles in this passage is that when you sow into another person's life, because here was a whole bunch of neighbors that gave her an empty pot, when you sow just a little bit, the Lord's able to do stuff, isn't he? So I don't know if you ever thought about that, but good probability that all of those neighbors got oil back, they got their pot back, and it was oil, and I'm sure she gave them a deal, being a good Jewish lady. Then the very next passage, so, and now everyone's got oil, so that's good. The very next story in verse 8 is the opposite. It says, one day Elisha went to a Shunan, a well-to-do woman. So this lady's at the other scale. She's a wealthy lady. And she is opening her home to Elisha. And you remember one day Elisha says to her, what do you need? And what she needs is she's barren. She needs to have a son. And you remember that she's opened her home, and she's added an extension or changed the room around so that every time Elisha's going by, that this is the room that he can go to. And the Lord not only gave her a son, which is what she was asking for, But when her son tragically dies, she also gets a miracle, because the very room that she's added for the prophet to stay in, she puts her boy on that bed, correct? And what she sowed into that man, she got a harvest in the very same way that she sowed. So you got two interesting little stories here. You got a lady who has nothing, borrows pots, and everyone who gave the pot was able to probably get stuff back. And then you've got this wealthier lady, and her need is very different. But the Lord's able to do breakthroughs for rich, for poor, for everyone. And can I just encourage you that every time the Holy Spirit asks you to be a giver, to be generous, that is an opportunity that you generally don't want to let pass by. What happened if that lady didn't have this generous thought to change a room around, have a spare room for the prophet? What happens if that lady doesn't go to any of her friends and she just gives up? Negative things would have happened. And I just want to encourage you, every time the Lord speaks to you and tells you to do something silly, like put a book on your back, there's potential for the anointing, for the oil to kick in, and for miracles to happen. Yes? Yes. So those of you that are here on a regular basis, you'll know that our Friday night offering goes into an account that we call a revival account. And so it's sowing into people like James Malone, who's going to be here tonight, James Maloney. It's sowing into all the different things that we do as a church, are just taking the Holy Spirit, the anointing around the world. And so if you'd like to give a gift to the Lord tonight, that's what it's going to go into. And if I can get those of you who've asked to be ushers, where are those who are asked to be ushers? Can I get you to grab one of the buckets, and we'll get ready to pass those in just a moment. If you'd like to give a gift tonight, there are some envelopes on a seat or in a seat very close to you, like in front of you or two, three away. And if you'd like to have a receipt, we're able to receipt Canadians and Americans. And if you'd like to have a receipt for your gift, if you could print as neatly as possible on the envelope, we're able to give you a receipt. If you'd like to write a check, you can make it to Catch the Fire. And for those of you with iPads and smartphones, where are you folks? iPads, smartphones? You don't have to do any of this. You're the cool people. You get to go right online, and on our website, ctftoronto.com, you can make your donation right there, and forget about all the paperwork and all that kind of stuff, and it's all looked after right there. So if you'd like to do that, you can do that as well. Father, thank you that no matter where we're at, whether we're poor, whether we're rich, that you speak to us all. And when someone says, what's the need? There's potential that God is able to meet that need every single time. And Father, we thank you that for those who are generous, for those who are listening to the promptings of the Holy Spirit, that there just seems to be story after story after story in the Bible that God is the giver for those who are generous. God's the one who pours back. God's the one who does things back into their lives. And Father, in this story, there's one lady who needed a financial miracle. There's another lady that needed a physical miracle for her body to be able to give birth. And then she needed a resurrection for her son. And Daddy, all of these things are possible because you're an amazing Daddy. And so we bless you tonight in Jesus' name. Amen. Good. So ushers, if you don't mind passing those buckets, that would be great. And Sandra, what would you like to say about tomorrow night? 7 o'clock.
So tomorrow night, we're going to be here, same place, but 7 o'clock, not 7:30. So, yeah, I think just one meeting. And then James will be here Sunday morning.
And that's 10:30 in the morning, Sunday morning. So we're looking forward to having you here. And can I encourage you to bring a friend tomorrow night? There's still room to add more folks. We can always add chairs at the side. We can always add some chairs at the back. And just looking forward to what God's going to do tonight and tomorrow. Can I encourage you that one of the things that we have found is if you're able to give 2 or 3 days in a row to a guest speaker and to what they carry, you're able to just get more, as it were, than to go to a meeting here and then 2 weeks go to another meeting and 2 weeks. There's something about just pushing in and receiving what a man or woman of God has to share, that sometimes it's not necessarily right then, the first meeting, that something happens, but it's second, third, fourth, those kind of things. And our history as a church is that many, many people came when we were having nightly meetings. They would come on a Monday, first meeting would be a Tuesday, and by the time Thursday, Friday, Saturday got home, they were full. They got what they came for, and God had their breakthrough for them. So can I just encourage you to, if you're at all possible, be here tomorrow night at 7, Sunday morning as well. Should be excellent. Next Friday night, we're having special guest speaker every Friday night all through the summer. We're calling it our summer series. And next Friday night, we have Bill Prankard with us from Ottawa. How many of you know Bill Prankard? Amazing, amazing man of God. He pastors in Ottawa Pentecostal Church. He has story after story after story of God using him, and especially with the Inuit people in northern Canada and northern Russia. However, that's not what he's going to be talking about. Not going to be focusing on healing. He's going to be focusing on financial breakthroughs. And one of the gifts that Bill has been given is to be able to pray for people, to be able to release finances. And so can I encourage you, he hasn't asked this, but if you have, could you bring a bill that next Friday night, just as a symbol of a debt that you have, that you need the Holy Spirit. So bring a credit card bill, bring a mortgage, bring a car payment, bring something like that. Have it in your pocket, have it in your purse, and just we'll see what the Holy Spirit's wanting to do. But I just know that as we expect God to do things, then that's a good thing, that God's always there for people who are expectant. In 2 weekends from now, we're having our party conference, our party weekend. And Friday night, we're going to be having John Arnott is going to be our guest speaker. On Saturday, it's going to be Carol Arnott, I believe, and Peter Jackson. And so it's going to be a Friday and Saturday. And the Saturday is going to be an all day. I think it's going to be 3 sessions, 10 a.m., 2 p.m., and 7 p.m. So we're looking to have get filled with the Holy Spirit. No apologies. We are going to be drinking that weekend, drinking Holy Spirit. So if you're not into the Holy Spirit stuff, stay away that weekend. But if you're into it, come, and that should be great. Great. Are we good? Well, can I just say that I am very much looking forward to hearing James Maloney tonight. James, when we were thinking about having you, John Arnott contacted Bill Johnson, who's one of your friends, and said, because we'd never had you speak here before, and it's like, tell us about this guy. And his words were that James Maloney is functioning in a level of miracles that nobody else is today. So that was from your friend Bill. So he owes you some money, or you owe him some money, or something like that. And just as I was reading, I only got to page 112, as I told you. I ran downstairs to tell Sandra, and she took the book, so I didn't get to keep reading anymore. By the way, the book is in our resource center. And what's it called again? It's Dancing? Yeah, I'm not sure if our bookstore is open again at the end tonight, but I think the books are going to be at the welcome desk tonight. This book, James, is called Dancing Hand of God. And it's the first chapter explains what he's talking about. James travels all over. He has schools. He's just a wonderful Bible teacher. You were at my son's church in Bath, England a while back. And he was telling me just amazing stories that you were telling, God using you in that church. Church, how about we stand up? Let's honor James Maloney.
Testing. Okay, they hear me. All right. How are you doing this evening? Of course, no pressure at all. I mean, thanks, Bill. I need to meet that guy someday. Hallelujah. I, again, just want to briefly mention the Dancing Hand of God, unveiling the fullness of God through apostolic signs, wonders, and miracles. Now everybody, ooh and all, ooh, all. Now you have to admit that's a nifty title, all right? But basically what it is 500 pages of signs and wonders and certain revelatory keys that the Lord gave me through 7 appearances from the Lord Jesus. My latest was May 7th, and I may share it with you this weekend. I experienced my first translation. I can share that with this congregation, right? Can I? And those that are watching, honestly, I was translated to another nation for 3 hours, and I was with the Lord, and this was in Uzbekistan, so that'll be in one of my books coming up, okay? So you may have to wait to hear about it then. But this is a book that Bill Johnson, you've heard of him, that forwarded it, and he says it's one of the best, if not the best book he's ever read. Wow, you know, I don't know about that. He's such a great author. But you'll laugh, you'll cry, you may even get angry at me a little bit. That's okay. But what it does is it shares about the breaker anointing that is to rest upon every individual, and how that you sit under ministries, servant leaders of this nature in this wonderful ministry, how there's an impartation. And I want you to say that word with me, impartation. Because I know we've heard that time and time again, but I do believe this weekend that this is going to be a real wonderful time of impartation. And I'll define that in just a few moments. But it's the dancing hand of God. Now, please refresh my memory. Do you have this copy, Pastor? No. So you just took it off of the...
Well, you gave it to Sean at the airport today.
Oh, I gave it... No, I did not give it to Sean at the airport. He stole one from the bookstore. It's yours. All right. Wait a minute. Wait. What's that mean? Sowing and reaping. I gave it to you. All right. No, you can give it to whomever you will. The last time I was here in Toronto was around the year 2000, 2001, in a full gospel businessman regional convention. And prior to that, I was here in 1994 when there was just a wonderful breakthrough. I have been traveling now almost 40 years. I know if my age, you can't tell that, right? But I started at 16, and I was born again and spirit-filled in the Jesus movement, in the early Jesus movement, charismatic renewal in Southern California. And the ministry among many, but you know, Lonnie Frisbee, the late Jill Austin, different ones that greatly influenced my life, Calvary Chapel, Via Vineyard, et cetera, et cetera. Then I went to Christ for the Nations, and I see a few of my students when I was a professor there for 7 years in the late 90s and early 2000, and it's just great to see you. But I'm from that era of the Jesus movement, and the ministry that revolutionized my life was the late Catherine Coleman. And we would go to the Shrine Auditorium, or she would come to what was termed Melody Land, and she would hold her miracle services, and I was all of about 17 years of age, and I was planning in going to the Naval Academy. I'd received my congressional appointment, and you know, I was prepared to fly fighter planes and play football for Jesus. And you know, I went to this miracle service, and all of a sudden this radio voice said, "And here's Catherine." And the platform was lower than the seats, and so the spotlight hit the back, and all of a sudden Catherine Coleman, it was like being shot out of a cannon, just came twirling down the aisle. And I was on the edge over here, and I turned around, and she had this big smile. She was just a unique individual, and she had about 10 yards of dress more than she needed material. And so she's just floating, and I'm looking at her, and all of a sudden about half of her dress just covered my entire body. And that's the last I remember for the next 4 to 5 hours. In fact, I was a little upset because I'd missed the miracle service. Really, I didn't miss anything. And I just, you know, was, you know, under the presence and the influence of the Holy Spirit. And when I finally came to, my life was radically changed. And so I have a great affinity and love for our dear sister, as well as others. Lonnie Frisbee was one of the first individuals that I was part of the hippie movement, part of that group where he said, "Holy Spirit, come, and then all of us hippies just fell under the power and cried out to God. So, you know, I go back a few years, and anyway, it's been just a tremendous 40 years of just watching God move to His glory and honor, and we do give Him all the glory and honor. And just recently, we moved from the nation of England, where we had the oversight of a school, the Supernatural. It's still ongoing. Had approximately about 200 students from about 30 nations, and turned it over to a young man and others. And so we're back here in the Dallas-Fort Worth, Texas Metroplex area, because I married a Texas woman, all right? So she said, if you want to, you know, move back to America, it's got to be in Texas. I would have preferred it to have been in Oregon or someplace, but Bill Johnson said it needs to be in Reading, and Randy Clark said, thus saith the Lord, Pennsylvania. So anyway, I'm in Texas, all right? But it's just really wonderful to be with you. This has been something over the years that I've just asked the Holy Spirit in His timing to allow me the privilege to share with this congregation of people. And I'm just going to share for a few moments. I know that's a relative statement. But no, really. And I'm going to begin to minister in an operation that I have recently, I've always ministered in it in one degree or another for 40 years, but recently it has become very, very distinct and acute, and it creates the gift of faith that falls upon the congregation, and we see to God's glory and honor some tremendous miracles. And it makes no difference to me if I'm in America, England, or Canada, or India. It's all the same. We see just as great a quality of miracles, and now quantity, as we do in other nations of the world. Hallelujah. And it's just not about myself. It's about, you know, what God is bringing us into in this era of time. So I'm anticipating some tremendous breakthroughs, amen, and miracles. And I know I've come to a congregation that sees it regularly and consistently, so all I'm doing is just kind of entering into the flow that's already established here, okay? But let it be a time of impartation, because there may be something that I'm moving in and operating in that will be distinctive in quality that you can receive for yourself, because anything and everything that God has done through my life is reproducible. It's impartational. It's not just for myself. I'm one that believes, you know, in the end time manifestation of the sons and daughters of the Most High, you know, manifesting the very person of Jesus Christ. So, you know, just let this weekend be not just a time that if you're in need of a miracle or a healing, and I assure you, as the Holy Spirit wills and directs, that before this weekend is over, you may not believe it, but I will minister to everyone that is in need of healing. So that may start tonight, and it may go into tomorrow night a little later, but my operation is through discerning of spirits and gift of faith, and the discerning of spirits initially rest in my hands. I'll bring more clarity to that tomorrow night in particular, and then I move in what's termed a seer operation. I can prophesy in what's termed Naba, personal words of prophecy. I've given tens of thousands over the years, and if the Holy Spirit wills and directs, I'll move in that. But I really felt this weekend in preparation that God wanted to just, as I move in the realm, you know what it means, the seer, I stand before the Lord and what He reveals to me, I will in a few moments begin to sense an angelic presence that will stand to my right side, and then I will call certain individuals out. And don't think that the Lord loves them more than you if I call them out. There's just timings in it. And how many know if that individual's being ministered to, it'll create faith for you wherever you're at, wherever you're seated, to begin to receive. And then we'll have as the Holy Spirit directs the ministry of laying on of hands and the impartation of discernment. It'll be fun. Hallelujah. Amen. And, you know, I love Bill Johnson. I think he's just an awesome gentleman. He's one of my dearest friends. And, you know, we give God all the glory and honor, right? I mean, just come on, you know. And what he's talking about is that seemingly, I just want to prepare you that we have in recent weeks and months seen a phenomenal, in fact, over the past many, many years, but in recent months, a phenomenal breakthrough in the area of creative miracles where bones are missing, organs are missing, pacemakers disappear. We've seen over 40 in the last 24 months. And hips that have had surgery, titanium hips, the metal dissolves, liquefies, dematerializes, becomes like a powder, falls on the carpet, you may see it. Fun, huh? And not just that, but, you know, any other condition that people may have, it's all important to the Lord. Hallelujah. All of it is. So let's just put our eyes upon Jesus. Amen. I know you will. And give him all the glory and honor. We just want to love on you this weekend. And I'm fresh. I've had 10 days of prayer and fasting. Hallelujah. Forgive me, I forgot my contacts, so I've got to wear my geeky glasses, which my wife just hates. But, you know, that's all right. She's not here. Hallelujah. But she may be watching, so I better be careful. I want to turn your attention just for a few moments to the epistle of 1 John chapter 3. The epistle of 1 John chapter 3. And while you're turning to our text for this evening, hallelujah. Boy, this is an exciting group. You're like a bunch of spiritual sponges. Just... By the way, I'm going to be with Brother Bill next week in Ottawa, so in the School of Ministry there. When I was at Christ for the Nations in Dallas, Texas, as a professor, I taught a class on the theology of healing and miracles. It was a fun class because periodically, of course, we'd minister in healing to the students and then have them minister to one to another. But always at the end of the semester, I would devote an entire morning ministering to the class of that particular subject. Now, usually the class would be between 250 to 350. It was an exciting class. And so, you know, I'm beginning to just minister to the students, and they've been sitting under the teaching for the entire semester, so they're all pumped up and ready, you know, to receive. And I remember a word of knowledge came to me, and the Lord, just as clearly as you're hearing me, said, there are 30 students down there that have deformities from birth that's created tremendous embarrassments for them. I want to heal them. So it wasn't just a matter that they needed healing of a particular deformity, but the rejection that ensued and just the pain of, you know, verbal abuse and condemnation in their upbringing. And so they need a lot of inward healing. And so I just gave out the word of knowledge, and it was quite amazing because 30 students came for it out of about 300, and they stood there, and when you looked at each one, you could tell immediately what was wrong with them. Like the first young man had what's termed a club foot, which means he was born with a foot that was partially created, and it was flipped upside down and just dangling there. And, of course, I had students that were working with me, and my son was there, and so there were a lot of staff, and this is not just documented, but, you know, In other words, there's individuals that can affirm this, okay, of tremendous integrity. And so the young man's foot was dangling there, and the power of the Lord was very strong. I mean, you know, you're operating under this sovereign, you know, word from God. I'm going to heal them. And so I remember I had one of the young men reach down and grab his foot. When that happened, his foot shook, and it flipped up, and then it just filled out completely to normal. Well, that got everyone excited. Pandemonium broke out, and that really got me excited. So we're going down the line, and I'll never forget one particular pastor friend of mine that was ministering with me from Louisiana. This gentleman's whole sternum was to the side, and so they had to do surgery to tie up his organs, you see, with stitches inwardly, because they were tearing the organs, and they had to lay him over, and so he's in excruciating pain. Well, when the pastor took his hand on his side, his whole sternum just cracked, snapped, and popped and moved back normally. That really got everyone excited. And so those were the type of miracles that we were seeing. And so as I'm ministering, you know, confidence is swelling and, you know, what's your condition and this and that. And everyone was 100% completely healed. I mean, deformities. Now, when we got to the last young lady, when you looked at her, you knew exactly what was wrong. That the left side of her face, when she was born with a grotesque deformity. I mean, it was just like a mangled look on her left side. Otherwise, she was a very beautiful young lady. But of course, you know, here was this mangled, I can't describe it to you. It was almost like, you know, a severe burn victim. And my heart just went out to her. And so I reached out to touch the side of her face. My heart as a spiritual father, I wanted to touch, you know, this young lady, but she recoiled. And I knew immediately we were dealing more than just, you know, a need for healing. She'd been, you know, of course, verbally abused over her lifetime, you know, among her peers and kids and this and that. And so, you know, she told us afterwards, she said, I never thought I'd ever, you know, marry or anything of that nature. Who would want me? And so my heart just went out to her, and I put my hand a second time. Now I want you to hear this, because there was this powerful anointing. But when I got to this young lady, it was like kicked up 100-fold. It's the only way I could describe it to you. You know, it's one thing to fall under the power. It's another thing when the authority and the glory of God is so resident that it keeps you from falling. It takes the anointing to keep you standing. And it was like a funnel of glory that came down upon myself, my son, my assistant, and this pastor from Louisiana, and different individuals, and we were just astonished. We were speechless. And I put my hand out a second time to this young lady. Now, when I did that, God is my witness, and this is in the dancing hand of God, it was like a person reached over my shoulder. Now, I had the physical sensation that a person came up to me, butted up his chest and shoulders up against my back, reached his arm over my shoulder. I'll never forget that, the feeling of it. Now, instantly, I thought, well, maybe this is an angel from the Lord, but it was the angel of the Lord, because immediately the Holy Spirit just impressed upon me, you know, there's a level of glory, but when the Son of Man comes into the place, there's glory. I know there's glory, and then there's glory. I know they're all one and of the same, but I mean, it was just another level, and he reached over. Now, I had this wasn't just, you know, in my mind's eye. Outwardly, I saw the similitude and the form of Jesus' arm in a white robe. And when I put my hand upon her face, he put his hand upon mine. Now, hear this. I'm already in my message. I'm teaching you right now. His hand entered into mine and joined and blended with mine. So there's no distinction between my hand or his. instantly when that happened, the cheekbone and the jawbone that was deformed on that side of her face softened like putty. All the bone became like jello. And my fingers went into her face. And Jesus began to massage her face with my fingers. Of course, it was his hand. It was his anointing. But he was using my hand, right? Are you with me? And all of a sudden, the scripture came to me that a potter will take a marred piece of clay and mold it after his design and purpose. And so for the next, 7 minutes or so, everybody's just aghast. I mean, my fingers are in her face. And we're massaging the different areas that was deformed. And after about 5 to 7 minutes, when the work was completed, he removed his hand. Mine went with his, and as my fingers came out of her face, I could feel the bone area harden perfectly, and this jaw area harden perfectly, and when I stepped back and looked at her, you could not find one trace of deformity. Now listen.
Hallelujah.
Isn't that great? She shook, wouldn't you? And she shook, and when she shook, she fell on her knees. Now, I still had the sensation that Jesus was still standing there. I could actually see his entire silhouette and similitude in his glorified state. It's what we call the similitude in Deuteronomy 4. And he was leaning down, and with these great big tears, he was just sobbing and weeping. And he was leaning down and listening and watching her response of worship. And I'll never forget, I'm kind of inquisitive. That's just who I am. I'm a German Jew, all right? So I'm very inquisitive. So I just stuck my Jewish nose down there. And I wanted to overhear the conversation. And she said, "Lord Jesus, thank you. Oh, thank you. You really do love me." She said it about 4 or 5 times. "You really do love me. I've been asking you for this miracle since I was 5 years of age." And here she was like probably 19 or 20. And she was just completely restored. So much so that it was my responsibility to have to call in at least 6 to 7 young men and set them down in my office who thought positively they'd heard from God this is the one that they were going to marry. Hallelujah. And wanted the prophet Maloney to affirm and confirm that was the will of the Lord, which is one of those no-nos that's a rarity, you know. It's quite humorous. There was a blending. There was a joining. Now, I want you to let that sink in your spirit. Because I'm going to share with you this weekend what I believe are some of the greatest keys to the release of greater miracles that God has promised all of us. And we have to grow and deepen beyond, as important as these healings are, beyond symptomatic healings to organic in nature. And what that simply implies is this. Symptomatic, I have a hurt back. You know, there's nothing wrong in that. We don't minimize the importance of that healing. And Jesus heals and takes the pain away. But there's a little bit of a difference when I have no vertebras and I need a creative or recreative miracle, or my arm doesn't function properly. How many know there's a little bit of a difference than I have no arm? How many know that's organic in nature? God has promised for us to experience all of those operations and those love encounters with him, because that's exactly what it is. And I believe that we're on the precipices. We're now. Everybody say the word now. Not on the threshold. Let me back up. We're on the threshold of something new and fresh and exciting. I've been hearing that for 40 years. We're on the threshold. I know what they're saying. There's some truth in it. We're on the threshold, and my response is, well, when? You know, I mean, eventually, some era of time, some season of time, we've got to get into a realm of operation that even goes beyond what I saw in the early charismatic renewal and the Jesus movement under Sister Coleman, as greatly anointed as she was. And they tell me even before that era, the 60s and 70s and the 40s and early 50s, there was even a greater manifestation of God's miraculous intervention. And even though we've seen some wonderful things to God's glory and honor, and I'm saying this individually and our ministry at large, but what I'm also saying is, yes, in the body of Christ, we need to see that increased, and God promised to the increase of his kingdom and authority and rule, there will be no end. So it's like, thank God for what he's done in times past. We need to build on that. Now, you know that. So what I'm going to share with you is a particular key that I have learned through two appearances directly from the Lord Jesus. Okay? And in 1 John chapter 3, won't be sharing very long, just hang in there with me. Everybody tell the person next to you, look at them, say, just getting good. Now, you got to say it like a Texan, this is getting good. In 1 John 3 and verse 18, my little children, let us not love in word, neither in tongue, but in deed and in truth. In deed and in truth. How many know we need more than just words? We need mercy demonstrated. Mercy needs to take on muscle. Amen. We need manifestation. I don't know about you, but I'm thankful for anything that God does. Amen. You know, I used to make the statement, well, I'm tired of partial healings and partial breakthroughs. And I kind of am. But yet, at the same token, I'm just excited that God does anything through his people and for his people and for humanity. I guess a half a cup is better than no cup of water, correct? Half a loaf is better than no. But what I'm saying is God is just, you know, bringing us into a greater sense of confidence and awareness of who we are in him. More importantly, who he is within us. And we've got to rise up in a greater sense, and I'm going to define this for you, confidence that as sons of God and daughters of the Most High, that the Lord will bring us into, again, those quote-unquote greater miracles. How many know? I really don't know what that means. I mean, everything's great. Everything's awesome in God. But let me just kind of give an illustration. How many know, you know, if you've got sore toes and someone lays hands upon you and the toes are healed of the soreness, how many know that's awesome? But how many know there's a little bit of a difference when I have no toes? Now, how many know with God, it's all the same? But on our end, hello? let's be honest, okay? Everybody look at me. I don't care how long you have been walking with the Lord. Now, some of you will disagree with this, but I know I'm right. Because I've had 40 years of experience and over 10,000 services. In Middle East countries, before Muslims, Sikhs, Hindus, that's where I predominantly ministers in the Middle East, as a forerunner going into nations, holding public meetings where it's illegal, and watch God heal to his glory and honor, establish his kingdom. But I don't care how long you've been walking with the Lord, how much faith towards God you've developed. There just comes a time that in and of yourself, you just do not have the necessary God kind of faith to see someone sitting in a wheelchair that have no legs and then believe that legs will appear. Let's just be honest. You may not like to hear that, but that's just the truth. So, you know, what God is saying is, everybody listen to me. It has absolutely nothing to do with you. Now, there's where we've got to get the revelation. Now, that's a whole other message. May share it Sunday morning, but I mean, it really doesn't have anything to do with you. See, we need to learn to minister for Jesus in the person of Jesus Christ. I mean, there's got to be an easier way, Pastor, to see greater miracles and greater breakthroughs. And trust me, in 40 years, I've gone through all the spiritual gymnastics. In my 20s, no young man or woman had anything over me. I mean, I bound, I loosed, I spoke in, I cast out, I pushed, I pulled, I spit on people. If you were in a wheelchair, I'd grab you, bring you up to my nose, throw you down on the carpet, knock crutches out from underneath you. All thinking that was some act of faith that God was just... it was just going to stir his heart to get that person healed. And, you know, honestly, I think it was just God protecting me. Some did get healed. There's got to be a greater rest here. I don't see Jesus working too difficult. I don't see he worked too hard in seeing people healed. Yeah, but you're saying... he had the fullness of the Holy Spirit without measure. That is what I'm saying. So somehow, as a son of God, we've got to somehow let the Son of God shine through us, and it's all to him and all of his fullness from his ascension position that sees those legs that aren't there appear. Have I seen that happen? Absolutely. Have I seen that happen in North America? Absolutely. I know you're sitting there and you're saying, well, we never heard of you. Because the Lord spoke to me in my early 20s and said that the vast majority of your life and ministry will be hidden. And if you want those miracles and healings, you'll have to remain hidden. Now, there will be an appointed time later on that you will come to the forefront, and it will help release the body of Christ at large into the operation. Because I'm all about everyone operating and moving and grooving in the Spirit. Boy, that dates me. But, yes, we have seen it. So, you want to know what one of the keys are? Here it is. Let's look at this in our text, and we'll tie this all together. When it speaks about the love, an agapeo love, not just in word, but in deed and in truth, what we need to come to understand is that the gifts of the Spirit, or the manifestations, or the glory, whatever you want to call it, the miracle manifestation, the prophetic manifestation that comes upon you, it is an expression of God's very person, or an expression of his desire to be joined spirit to spirit. Did you hear that? I'm going to elaborate on it. I'm not going to repeat it. You can get the CD afterwards for $100, all right? To minister an agapeo love, or agape love, simply means that we've got to be open and available to minister to the unmet love needs in the lives of people. When someone is sick or afflicted, it's not just the healing in and of itself, as important as that is. It is whatever need they have emotionally, spiritually, mentally. God, who is love, manifests himself. He reveals his heart. See, it's not just that God has the ability to heal. He is healing. You didn't get that. Let me try over here. There was just dead silence over there. I think they're asleep. Let me try over here and see if I get any response. It's not just that God has the ability to heal. He is healing. No, you still don't get it. When he says, I am the Lord that healeth thee, whenever you hear the phrase I am, whatever precedes it, I am Jehovah Rapha, Jehovah Jireh, whatever, it means that I am unchanging in what I'm revealing to you and my redemption towards humanity. I change not. So I am the Lord that healeth thee. I am Jehovah Rapha, which means I will mend your life through stitchwork. Now, this is Professor Maloney. Trust me, you can do your word study. They know, all right? I'm into word study, so forgive me. But it does illuminate, doesn't it? Jehovah Rapha, Rafika, if you speak Spanish, Raphael. English, Ralph. Kind of loses a sense of dignity there, doesn't it? I love you, Ralph. No, that's really true. The root meaning. When he says, I will send forth my word and heal you, what that means is a living piece of evidence of who he is manifested to you. And it meets an unmet love need. Because if you're physically healed, then confidence arises. He truly loves me, like the little girl said. And so you experience a measure of revelation and illumination of your mind. You're renewed, and you go from one level of glory to another experiential level of glory. Now, I'm telling you by the Spirit, we're all this weekend going to move into another realm of glory. And this is going to be for the purpose of releasing the greater breaker anointing for what we would commonly term greater miracles. And it's not just the individual, as important as they are, you know, that operate in it. We're just servant leaders that just, we're just, if we're a forerunning type of individuals, it's just for the purpose of exciting this, you know, a rising, emerging generation of young men and women, glory to God, that will just take and even go further, higher and deeper in the Lord. Amen? But you need to understand what it means to love in deed and in truth, that you may know. Listen to what it goes on to say. And hereby we know that we are in the truth. Do a word study on the word to know, because from that derives the word a joining, a sealing. It's an amazing, amazing word. Hereby we know that we're in the truth is because we love not just word, but indeed and in accordance to God's truth. And that word truth there, aletheia, eleutheroo, everybody say that with me, aletheia, eleutheroo, everybody say it 10 times real quickly. Oh, you're speaking in tongues. All right. It means truth that exhibits a virtue. See, it's not just the truth will set you free. The truth will not set you free. Hear this. The truth will not set you free. It is the truth that you know that's what will set you free. And it goes deeper than just, you know, how many of you can know someone and then you can really know someone. Correct? And this is what God's bringing you into, so that if you come into that greater anointing, that joining of his heart with yours, spirit to spirit, blending, union, it's Christ in you. That's what we're all anticipating. This is what our hope is in, that the glory of God will be manifested in all of his fullness, amen, in and through empty vessels of clay, come on now, and that Jesus will shine in his fullness through his people. That's what the manifestation of the sons of God is all about. And listen, let's go on, and it says, and hereby we know that we are in the truth and shall assure our hearts. Everybody say the word assure. I love the word assure, to have assurance. How many of you want to have an assurance in God? That when you look to him as a son to your father, that there's a simplicity, an ease, and a rest that you have complete access and with his undivided attention to whom who sits on the throne. Okay, here's the key. The derivative word for to be assured in that, because you're being joined in the Lord, because you want the agapeo love to be expressed to meet people's unmet love needs, the word assure here means you're going to like this. Tell the person next to you, say, you're really going to like this. Come on now. Now, there's a derivative word to assure with assure. It's acceptance. And this is what it means. You're accepted in the beloved, it says in Ephesians. I accept you with the same fervency of acceptance that I accepted my own son when he walked the earth. I accept you with the same fervency of acceptance that I accepted my own son when he walked the earth. I haven't even tried any of you in the middle, right? One of the words, and when I close here in a few moments, I will go to this word and define it greater. For the word glory. Everybody say glory.
Glory.
Say it like a Texas evangelist. Glory.
Glory.
It's the word, you know, in the Hebraic, it's, you got to, you know, I got to get some phlegm out. It's thuxa. It's doxa. D-O-X-A, it's where we get the word doxology. It means this, God's opinion and how he sees you through his son. Now, if you get a revelation of that, you will rise in an assurance, a knowing, come on now, a love encounter with him. You'll love not just in word, but in deed and in truth. Listen to what it goes on to say here. For if our heart, have you ever read this? Sure you have. And like me, for years I never understood it. For if our heart condemns us, God is greater than our heart and knoweth all things. So that tells me something. Everybody look at me. In my flesh mind and my flesh emotions, there's absolutely no way in my flesh, are you hearing this, that I'm going to have the capacity or the capability to believe in that flesh realm for these greater miracles. Now, I can hope that, you know, maybe someday it'll happen, but to have the assurance that when I look at a person or lay hands upon the person, that I'm accepted in the beloved, that God will move just as quickly in my life as if Jesus literally himself was standing here. Now, there's, again, a whole other message where it is Jesus appearing in and through his people before his great appearing and manifesting and shining through his sons and daughters. That's a whole nother message and level. But let's just digress for a moment. God is saying, look, you're accepted. There's acceptance. You've got to know how I perceive you, my opinion. What's important? His opinion about you or you about yourself? Read my book. My God, I mean, listen, I received, if you want to consider this a revelation, directly from the Lord. I know that's a very strong statement, but I don't apologize. Listen to what it says. So if I don't have the assurance, then that means down here in the flesh realm, I'm trying to believe God for these greater miracles. So obviously, there's got to be a separation from the soulish life and the spirit. Because if I can learn what it means to come up higher, get into his realm in my spirit, Amen? And become joined with his heart, since he knows all things, he knows my heart. But if our heart condemns us not, the reason why my heart doesn't condemn me is because I'm locked with his. It's all about him. Then if I'm in that high realm, then we have confidence towards God. And whatever we ask, we receive of him because we keep his commandments and do those things that are pleasing in his sight. And this is the commandment. Now, forget about it. I can't do this and I can't do that syndrome. This is what it's saying is the commandment, that we should believe on the name of the Son of Jesus Christ. And that'll bring the greater miracles. Yes. Rest. Everybody say the word rest. See, this should be your prayer. Okay? Then I'm going to finish up over here. I do see in closing. Now, that's a long in closing, but I'm going to get there. Hallelujah. A few more moments. We'll begin to administer God's grace. Is that all right? How many know we're already ministering? Had a while back, two ladies thought they were whispering, but they were deaf. So everybody could hear what they were saying, and hadn't been healed yet, and they said, I wish you'd stop preaching and start ministering. Let me take you some, I'm already there, so save you time. This is real quick. In Matthew 6, when it speaks about, and this is a whole other message, we'll not get into it, that if you abide in the secret place, what you do in secret, he will reward you what? Openly. And how we should pray, our Father which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Okay? Now we always quote that, and rightfully so. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as they're experiencing it in heaven already. That's correct. But you need to read it in the Arabic, Syrian Arabic original language that Jesus spoke. And it's not just talking about whatever's happening in heaven's realm, we've got to breach this flesh earth realm and bring heaven down into this earth realm. Everybody look at me. Heaven is already abiding within you. Now, I'm not misconstruing and saying that that's wrong teaching. I agree with it. I teach on it, open heavens. But what I'm saying is, let's just take a step further here. We've had 10 years of that teaching. Heaven is already abiding within you. If somehow you can ascend in your spirit, man, in the realm where God is, and besides, you're seated with him in heavenly places positionally, we just got to make that experientially, then this should be your prayer. There needs to be a separation from the soul and the spirit. Listen to the Lord's Prayer in the Aramaic that Jesus prayed. O birther of the cosmos, focus your light within us. Make it useful. Create your reign of unity now. Your one desire that acts with ours. As in all light, so in all forms. Grant us of what we need each day in bread and insight. Loose the cords of mistakes binding us as we release the straits we hold of others' guilt. Don't let surface things delude us, but free us from what holds us back. For from you is born all ruling will, the power and the life to do, the song that beautifies all from age to age, it renews. I affirm this with my whole being. Everybody look at me. This is the earth. It's personalized. Do you know what your commissioning is in the Lord? Minister to the person in front of you. If you minister and extend the rule of God's kingdom to the person in front of you, it'll just start an expansion outwardly. We're all trying to live up here when God says, I'm already abiding with you and heaven is already here. Just let your light shine. Is that what it says? Matthew 5 says, let your light shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven. Here's the Aramaic. Let the light of your being radiate and illuminate the frail humans in front of you that they may see your rightness and that they may see, as they see your rightness, they will be reconnected in praise to your Father in heaven. Rightness, hub, H-U-B, means saying the right thing or doing the right thing at the right time. Jesus said, the light is in you. Now, again, I'm not misconstruing, minimizing what happens in heaven. Yes, it needs to be brought into this realm. I'm just saying it's already here. God's here. Well, see, I want God here. Hear this. I want God to show you the gift that he's given you to exercise your faith towards him and see miracles. See those kind of miracles. But you got to define what a miracle is. This is the best derivative definition I've found for miracle. Explosive astonishment of revelation in the healing demonstration. I'm going to say that one again. Explosive astonishment of revelation in the healing demonstration. When God works a miracle, if it's a healing, a prophetic word, how many, everything that God does on your behalf, provision financially, it's supernatural, it's miraculous. It is a sign of God's heart revealed. Let's use the in the context of healing. It's the sign of God's heart revealed in the healing. It's a demonstration, do you like that word? Of his, not only authority, but a demonstration of his love. A person is to be, now hear this word, because there's a synonymous word to miracles, signs. It means to be marked by God's love, which is to bring you into obedience to his will. And what we need is we need earthen vessels of clay, not just to be imitators of God as dear children, there's a truth in that, but we really minister out of, yes, as an imitator, we minister out of the character of Christ, but there is a season of time and this end time ministry that's fastly approaching where it's just going to be all of Christ and his fullness being seen in and through his people. That's blending. That's joining. Are you hearing this? Ministering out of the character of Christ. You know, when I was 20 years of age, I was seeing just as great of healing signs and wonders as I see now. Maybe the only difference is maybe hopefully and prayerfully I'm ministering more out of his heart, his character. Because it's not just the healing or miracle. How many know there can be a lot of anointed healing jerks out there? Don't look around. Don't ask who I'm talking about. I just want confidence. Amen? I want to walk in assurance. I want to love in deed and in truth. I'm tired of living down here and struggling and trying to believe for the greater miracles to happen. For my flesh mind and my flesh, you know, emotions that still is being renewed when God says, look, I just want you to rise up. The anointing abides within you. The kingdom is already within you. It's in you. So Lord, remove all debris soulishly. Remove everything that hinders me. I mean, it's going to come a time in your walk with the Lord that these types of miracles, it's going to be easy. If you got to work and strive to try to make it happen, it's more of you, less of him. That's why they're not happening. Jesus would just have someone stand in front of him and say, what's your condition? Laid hands on him. Next, next, next. And, you know, it's so remarkable. He didn't even have to use his name. I was just thinking about that. And my, you know, and God, you know, we have to use the name of Jesus. You know, he just, I don't know. It was easy. Yeah, but he was the Son of God. He is the firstborn of many brethren to bring many sons into glory. Oh, and I'm telling you, it marks you. Everybody say, be marked to the person next to you. Be marked. Let me tell you what that means as we finish up. It means, how many of you want to be marked? No. You better be careful before you lift your hands. It means the heavy weightiness or imprint of God. It means the finger of God. It means the imprint of God, the weightiness of God. A person who is marked by God is brought into not just obedience to his will, but to the glory of God. And listen, we've got to minister in a realm or out of a realm of his presence. And it's abiding within us and all around us. And yes, it comes down, but it's just already within us. And I'm trying to get you to die. You are to die. No, not physically, but to die. Because your life is hid in Christ and in God. Doesn't mean it's not there, it's just hid. You've got to get a revelation of that in Colossians. You need to invite me back and I'll teach on it. Hallelujah. You know, if it's Christ in you and there's such a freedom and liberty and ease and there's no condemnation, I have assurance. See, some of the greatest miracles I've ever seen that God's going on, or was it because I fasted for 30 or 40 days? I'm not minimizing that, bound and loose, this or that, spoken tongues, as important as that. It's just, Father, I'm your son. These are your sons and daughters. And I'll share with you tomorrow night how I got to that, because it wasn't easy to get to that. The gift to see miracles and move and exercise your faith towards God, and the gift of being marked. You know what happens? When you receive something from God, in a few moments I'm going to minister to many of you, you get marked. And what happens is if you get, it marks a person, which means God's put his finger upon you, which means the very thing you've received, then what happens is it's got to change you so that you become a reproducer of the very thing. What it does is it opens up your spirit and gives you a continual testimony of experience so that you become a healer in Christ. So whatever you're healed of, then in turn, you're to give healing to others. And the confidence should be there. I mean, the confidence should be there with or without God doing something for you, just based upon the word. But the point is this, God understands, you know, that people need signs. They need wonders. How many know we need signs and wonders? Signs and wonders are not two different things. Everything that God does is a sign. But some of the things that God does makes you wonder. So look at the person next to you and say, you're a sign that makes me wonder. That's the wrong connotation, isn't it? Come on now. I gotta finish. In closing. No, I really am. Ephesians 2:22 says we are the habitation of God. Everybody say dwelling place. Habitation. I'm sorry, I'm old. I preach out of the old King James. But, you know, if you've got those newer, wimpier translations, that's okay. You know, they'll work. We're the habitation of God. How many know that individually and corporately? We're the habitation. No, you're not getting it. We are the habitation. Okay, let me define for you what that means. We'll go into greater detail tomorrow night. What you are seeing, hearing, and discerning, you will become like. How many, what you adore, worship, and you're intimate with, you will become like the person that you adore, worship, and you're intimate with. That's why God hates idols, because the people end up becoming like the idols they worship. They take on the characteristics of a little dung heap. That's what the word idol means. A pile of... What you are seeing, hearing, discerning, you'll reflect. Habitation means this, kato, K-A-T-O, the governing authority of God set in motion from a higher precipice down to a lower place. So if I'm the habitation of God and I've experienced a separation of soulish and spirit, and my spirit man is ascending in the realm where God's heart is, and I'm blending and being in union and joining, just like my illustration, my hand became his. Are you hearing this? Then in that realm, I'm not operating in the flesh realm anymore, because it always falls short. God condemns sin in the flesh. There's no good thing that comes out of people's flesh. It's got to be of your spirit, where the Holy Spirit resides. We've got to get up where God's heart is. And if we're with God's heart, how many know nothing's impossible with him? Then nothing becomes impossible with us, because it's his heart. Then I have confidence. I have assurance. Hallelujah. And then he who is governing from a position of a higher precipice will manifest in this natural realm. It also means to discern, hear, speak. And as you're hearing, discerning, and speaking, all of his action or manifestation will be made available. The other derivative word means you are expressing who he is in the dwelling place. That's where he lives with his people, who are joined with him here on earth. And the word also conveys that we are like a mansion, thoroughly furnished. We are in his abode. He makes his abode with us. If the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, Jesus said, abides within us, he will... You know, amen? We'll love him. He will make his abode. You will become like a mansion. And then there's the opinion of the person's word. Everybody look at me. God is entrusting to these end times what we'll term, and I'll clarify, a dove company that's going to ascend to the windows of heaven. That's going to enter into rapturous experience, translation experiences, that they're going to rise as the dove. They're going to manifest Jesus, his person in fullness. It's not just an air that I'm an imitator and I've got a measure of anointing I'm operating. Yes, God says there's a generation that's going to enter into the greater fullness where it's just, we're so emptied and so dead, we're so hid, it's Christ within us, the hope of glory and his fullness. He is going to appear before his appearance, hallelujah, through thousands upon thousands of Christians. Hallelujah, I'm getting excited here. Maybe I'm the only one. That's what it means to be his habitation. You are being marked by a miracle. Amen. Let your light shine. The people in front of you. I'm all for prophetic intercession, and if you're led and directed by the Holy Spirit, you know, what is the principality and power? If you're led by the Holy Spirit. If you're led by the Holy Spirit. But if you notice the ministry of Jesus, he just ministered to people right there. And then it extended beyond. Supernaturally. God will take care of all of that up there. If we'll minister to the person in front of us. So you know what happens? When someone gets healed, you know what happens? Is that a breaker anointing breaks out in the specific geographical location. And it pulls down principalities and powers. And it famishes the gods that everybody worships. And you'll find that reference. It's a whole other message in Acts 19, 11 and 12. Special miracles. When the individuals' hands were laid upon them, even though they were experiencing something extraordinary, something was done in the realm of the Spirit that went into the very vicinity of the upper coast of Ephesus, the Ephesus area, and it just absolutely destroyed the paganism, famished the gods. But he ministered to people individually. See, a miracle is a weapon in and of itself. It's not just standing there and saying, Jesus' name, I command this principality and power to be pulled down. You know what most of their responses will be? The people have given me this position. Hello? Well, you see, I've closed my notes, which means nothing. Oh, now you're really seeing it. I'm taking my coat off. Everybody say, thank you, Jesus. Say, hallelujah. He's done. Well, some of you actually said it. No, I'm done. I don't remember what I said. I never preached that message before, so it's yours. How many of you want to be, now this is no trick question, how many of you want to be a real mouthpiece for God? It's okay. You want to know what one of the greatest keys is? How many like to know? Breath spray. So that are you watching by the live stream internet. How many of you believe nothing is impossible with the Lord? That's not a trick question. You get your hands up. Nothing is impossible. But here's the issue. Nothing is impossible with God, but he wants to work through you. And me. And you know what? That's the way he likes it. He loves to use earthen vessels of clay. Amen. The glory of his majesty may manifest where he gets all of the glory, all of the honor, all of the praise. See, I don't, I just don't want healings or miracles, just a means in and of himself. I want more of who he is. Catherine Coleman had that revelation. It's all about him. It's all about him. Begin to worship him. See the glories here. It's all about him. It's all about him. As I begin to minister here, I want you to just keep worshiping him. Give you a little bit of instruction, since you don't know who I am. You put your hands down and you look right up here at me, and we give you a little bit of instruction. I know you're checking me out, but it goes both ways. And to be honest with you, I don't get intimidated. You can't be intimidated and minister to Muslims or Presbyterians. No, excuse me. Hallelujah. I'm sorry. Forgive me. I know I'm going to get a terrible email. I didn't mean that. Quit getting religious. I don't like ministering with glasses. I miss my contacts. Look, I don't minister in a spooky, mystical way. Okay. Used to. Go down the aisle and half the people run out the back door. Everybody has an aspect or an angle of who Christ is in their operation, and no one singular individual is more important than the next person, and no singular individual has the fullness of Christ in expression and manifestation. I have an aspect. You have an aspect. When we get the entire body of Christ in the fullness of operation, then we'll see the fullness of Christ. Amen? But let me just say this. I'm going to step down here and pray I don't break. I know that's a bad confession. I am a faith man. Those are steps. Last time I was here, the platform was in the center, seemed like, or something. Oh, yeah. I mean, there's more space behind there? Oh, okay. That's the, okay. I just remember everybody was in a circle, and I was about right there, and Brother Arnott said, "More." I go, "More what?" So I laid under the power laughing for 3 hours. I go back. There's a verse. Now, what's happening here? I can minister right now on anyone and anybody that breathes and moves. I could minister prophetically to every single person in my gifting. But I'm waiting for just another minute, more of a concentrated, and I'll share more tomorrow night about it, focused glory that rests. And because of an episode I went through 2 years ago when I almost died, had adrenal fatigue and failure, God has birthed out of my weakness something that I'm growing in, I'm deepening in, and it's going to be your portion too. Isn't that great? And so I am reliant upon, and I'm not trying to mimic anybody else's ministry. Please hear this. I don't have any other person's mantle. You know, I don't want them. You know, I just who I am. I'll share more in detail tomorrow night. I have an angelic person that arrives and stands to my right side And I'm to the point now where I really don't care what anybody thinks. I really don't. You can believe it or not. Okay? This thing here is funky. No, don't take it out.
Just squeeze it tighter.
Just squeeze it there. It's all grown up. He's a whippersnapper when I saw him last time. I had to cast demon out of him one day. No, I'm just saying. Huh? Just one? There's quite a few. Hallelujah. But no. A few more? No, I'm teasing. So have fun, okay? Let your hair down. Okay. Just, you know, I'm a nice dude, all right? And what I'm going to do is I'm going to have you do something. And I'm going to have you, if you're born again and baptized in the Holy Spirit and you pray in tongues, okay, now please don't war over semantics, okay? If you're baptized in the Holy Spirit but you don't have your heavenly language yet, just pray in English. But I have what's termed interpretation of tongues. The secrets of men's heart are revealed. So what happens when you pray in tongues, I'm going to take 1 minute, I'm going to go down the aisle, I'm going to look and span, and I actually have certain light flashes that I see through discerning of spirits, and these are the individuals I'm going to call out, and I can actually, while you're praying in tongues, interpret an aspect of what you're saying. Then when you come up here, then I will minister. I have discerning of spirits in my right hand. I will take your right hand in mine. I'll clarify it more tomorrow night. And the angel will stand to my right side. You will know it. It's not some mental suggestion. He either will be here or he won't. And not saying he always has to, but this is just the operation I'm moving in now. And what will happen is there will be more secrets, more events. What I have is, I have now, is focused. I have from my spirit man, my illuminates my thoughts, and my thoughts jump out on the wall. And I just see, it superimposes on the wall, and I see, and I just describe what I'm seeing. It's called panorama. So you can get my book, November 1st, Destiny Image, The Panoramic Seer, for greater clarification. It's coming to the whole body of Christ. Okay? So it's like, I'm a forerunner. I'm not the only one. There's others. But I just, from left to right. So what happens is, I'll minister to maybe three or four. It is five, six, seven. It's the most exhausting time because I have this glory that comes down upon us, and it absolutely, in 40 years of ministry, I've never had such a fatigue. Then it lifts. I may have further words of knowledge. So what I'll do is either tonight for a little bit, tomorrow night as well, however long, I'll usually get a stool. That doesn't sound right. I will sit on a stool. Though you can get great revelation sitting on a stool. A high chair. Well, you can laugh in a minute here. And what I do is, you know, for length of time, from my right, your left, you must always come to my right because the angel does not leave. This is not a healing angel. This is an angel of discernment and strengthening me, and strengthens me to be able to handle that kind of glory. What happens is when the secrets, events are revealed, then the gift of faith, and there's no way I can know those details in a person's life unless the gift of faith comes down on me. I don't guess, I don't try to make them up, I don't fish. You know, I just, whatever I see, I just describe. Some are very lengthy, some are very short. Who cares? As long as you get touched. Before I begin to minister in that, because he's coming now. Ooh, this young lady right here with her hair put up, you're being touched in your neck, left ear, down your left shoulder. There's like a pull. There's been something on a pull from your clavicle, real strain, is that correct? Heat's going through your body right now. It's going to affect the whole left side of your body. It's going to deal with a nerve that is getting incited, uncomfortable, where it's created a certain numbness and stiffness in your lower back. The issue is not your lower back. The issue is up there by your shoulder and the left side of your neck. You just got healed. God wouldn't reveal it to me unless he wanted you healed. You just affirmed it. That is not panorama. That is just a word of knowledge that everybody can move in. This is panorama. Let's pray in tongues. Hallelujah. Don't look at me. Just pray in the Spirit. Let me do this for about 15 or 20 minutes, and then I'll spend the rest of the time up to about 11 to minister, and I'll sit on the chair. Come on, pray in the Spirit. I know this may sound a little weird for you. You may have never had anybody do this, but there's tongues and interpretation of tongues. And I'm an interpreter in this situation. So when I look and span, I get flashes from my peripheral vision. In Jesus' mighty name. I'm going to minister to you in just a moment, okay? I'm going to minister to you in just a moment. Right now, hallelujah. And it's not that the ones that I'm seeing that God wants to minister to, God loves them more than you. You got more maturity than that. There's just timings. I cannot minister. The most I think in panorama has been 12 to 15, and at about I had to be carried out of the meeting. It is so exhausting because there's so much concentrated glory. It's actually like a pillar of fire that comes down upon myself and upon the individual. Hallelujah. Come on, worship the Lord right now. This is different. Catherine Coleman ministered in one way. Others minister in other ways. I'm an apostolic seer, prophet. You're going to pray in the Spirit. Hallelujah. I'll minister to you in just a few moments. Hallelujah. Now, there'll be others that I will call out in just a few moments. Let me look. Doesn't matter if you're from the front or the back. Doesn't matter. I can see you. Hallelujah. If this is, I don't think it is for this congregation, but if this is a little different, good. We want it to be different, unique. There's a variety of ways that God ministers. Those that are watching via internet, don't let this setting or the camera setting limit you from receiving right where you're at. God extends beyond. That's what I said. If I individually minister here, it'll extend beyond this congregation into your living room, at your office, wherever you're at, you receive it. If any aspect that I reveal in a person's life, you have the same condition, receive it. That's for everyone seated here, those that are watching via internet. Hallelujah. Okay, I want this lady in the yellow to come here, and let's minister to her. And please understand, I'm not trying to intimidate you. Everybody look at me. I know it's kind of putting you on the spot. There's a lot of shyness in the body of Christ, and they don't like to be put on the spot. Okay, but listen. This is nothing to be afraid about. Amen? If this is an operation of the Holy Spirit, this is for this sister. Hallelujah. any aspect that I reveal, it's for you as well. You receive it where you're seated. Understand that in a few moments, a gift of faith is going to begin to dump on this congregation, because when it comes on me, it will come upon you. Hear this. When I leave after this weekend, the gift of faith, you have it here in operation, but it's going to be higher and deeper. It's going to be more perfected. And then others like Joshua and different ones will come on and add to it. We thank God for all of the ministries. Hallelujah. Hello. You didn't expect this, did you? That's okay. I want you to come here. Take my right hand. Now, don't you fall down on me. Hallelujah. I know that sounds strange. Now, what is your name?
Foster.
Foster. Where are you from?
Foston.
Foston?
Where
are you from?
India.
Where?
Mumbai.
Mumbai, you have to sit down. Hallelujah. No, come here. My daughter's from India. I love India. India is my second home. Hallelujah. So you're a man of God, aren't you?
I am, sir.
All right. I want you to experience, see, there's a very large angel, about 7 foot tall. I've had countless people describe him to the T in different areas of the world. So we're going to have, what is it again?
Foston.
Foston. We're going to have Fosse here. No, I'm led to do this. Why don't you get right over there, and I want you to lift your hands, because really, Foston, there is an impartation that's coming to you, and it's touching your right hand that's going to open up a door, give you favor amongst leaders that have been resistant to a move of the Spirit and very religious. And you're being trained apostolically and pastorally to oversee a whole region. Hallelujah. I see east and a little south. I see the Gants in the south, that the Lord's going to give you great favor. I see in the Kerala state something that God's going to make a connection in 2 years. Let's say I'm moving to Naba. You know, when I was a professor of Christ for the Nations, everybody wanted to know God's purpose for their life and this and that. See, this isn't Syria. This isn't, I'm just prophesying. But the angel's touching him and imparting. Hallelujah. And it's the Holy Spirit through, of course. He's just an empty... Oh, there you go there, Fosse. Hallelujah. You had something 3 or 4 years ago in your stomach that was a distress or a discomfort that was parasitical. You ready to get set free?
Yeah.
This thing has kind of been coming and going, is weakened the upper tract of your intestines.
Whoa.
This was 3 years ago. The Lord's touching you right now.
Whoa.
And he's gonna use the ingenuity of his creative Daniel anointing to really take the technology of the world, you know, communications, and really in the business arena bridge the nations. And with that will come ministry. Hallelujah. Oh, he's a lot of help. Okay, Pastor.
Would you like someone else?
Hello. Don't be afraid. Don't be shy. I sense that you are very open to this. You love the Lord with all of your heart. But you've had a very difficult life. And yet the last 8 or 9 years, there's been some wrinkles that have been ironed out. God's done a great work within your life. You know that? There's been some wounding. There was at about 20 to 21 years of age, in your late 30s as well. Relationships were torn down. you have estranged relationships now with two people that God's going to restore in the next 2 to 3 years. Isn't that wonderful?
Amen.
That aren't speaking, that aren't communicating, because they see you as you were, not how you are now. And so the Lord is having to synergize the organs in your body that have been weakened. So your immunity system, now I'm seeing it, your immunity system is being touched right now. Do you need that?
Yes.
No, I mean, you really do need your immunity system healed. Because I see a blood infection and a mono infection many, many years ago, and you lived through 5.5 months of anemia to 6 months where you practically were bedfast. You couldn't move around but in your living room at the most, up in your bedroom. It was just very difficult. It was just a very trying time. The Lord is quickening your body right now in Jesus' name. I see that you had some hemorrhaging within your body. The Lord is correcting the intimate area of your body right now in Jesus' name. Would you like that?
Yes.
You understand what I'm saying to
yes.
you? Hang in there, sweetie. I know it's where the glory realm has come upon us. It's good, isn't it? Your bronchial tubes have been greatly affected. This is your main condition. Even though this is self-inflicted, yet that's in the past. God reverses the curse. God will restore. Your bronchial tubes have had polyps. It has had a roughness in your breathing. It has affected your right lung in particular. And this has been creating a circulation problem. And God wants you healed right now so you can breathe. Because see what's happening, if you don't get touched now, you're going to have more oxygen. You're not getting sufficient oxygen in the realm of the natural. So there would have to be an enhancement in that. The Lord wants you healed right now in Jesus' name. One other thing, I see that you had on the right side in the back of your mouth a tooth situation. Okay, that was very painful, and there was an abscess, and it put poison within your body, and you've had some slight symptoms of heart scenario that's irregularity because of your mom and your grandmom, and this has been hereditary, and it's actually seized you. It was like a seizing of your heart. This is about 18 months ago the Lord is showing this to me. Shortness of breath. You remember that? You were just incoherent. I mean, you were just short of breath, dizzy. This was heat related as well. And you just had to virtually sit in that little car you drive and just catch yourself. The Lord's ministering to you right now in Jesus' name. Ready to be made whole?
Amen.
You understand what I've shared with
yes,
you?
Sir.
You don't have to go down. Stand up.
This is how you stand up.
No, I want to see you. This is what's called a stasis or ecstasy. I like to see people wobble back to their chair. It's easy for you to fall down. So you can go that away, and everybody give God all the glory and honor. I want this lady in the back in the glasses. Yeah, because your knees are being touched right now. And your right ankle's being touched. And the varicose veins are being touched. It's too quiet in here. Now, do you notice how I'm working you all up? Isn't it real hyper? When I was 30-something, yeah, I was hyper. I'm 56, I'm not hyper anymore. Hello. You didn't expect this, did you? I know you did. Take my right hand. When you take my right hand, you should begin to sense the spirit. You make, I hate to use the word connection. That's just. But I sense someone that's welcoming this. Believes in it. Where's Fosse? Get back up here and go to work. Isn't that a great word? I can't remember his name. Faustin. Yeah, I know, but I'm going to call you Fosse. And you think I'm wasting time. I'm not, because what's happening is the glory pillar is coming down upon us. Ooh, fell, saw it. I just saw it. And she says, she knows she's getting an, you're getting a side profile of this angel. Isn't that amazing? I see a slight paralysis that God wants to touch you right now. See, I'm seeing from left to right. It throws itself out on the wall. So it's kind of easy, you know what I mean? I mean, you know, all I got to do is just what I see, describe. Pretty cool, huh? You can have this. It's coming to you. Hallelujah. I operated this way for years in different, you know, calling people. I didn't know what was going on. No one taught me. So the Lord just, when I got very weak, God said, I want you to concentrate and listen. And so the angel is strengthening me right now. Strengthening her, obviously, right? You had an impact on your body 3 times, but the last one was the worst. You fell, it affected your entire left side of your body. Is that correct? I see some particular object on the floor that you stepped on. It's going to be another incident. Bruised your heel. Huh? I think the dog put it there. Get rid of the dog. No, I'm not. Nah, you love him. He's family, right? 3, get rid of him, all right? I see one particular dog, chew bone or something. I don't think it was a chew bone. It was something that he wasn't supposed to chew. That she stepped on, and it bruised her left heel, and it's not healed correctly. You fell at another time as well, and it's your left hip. Is that correct? And your whole shoulder was, the muscles was ripped off, kind of pulled off of the clavicle. You have numbness on one side of your physical, one side of your body, and also you have in your pancreas a need of a rejuvenation because it's sluggish in your thyroids and your pancreas. Would you like God to touch you? You understand what I'm saying to you? This is going to help you in the circulation in your feet and the circulation in your legs. Because you fell on the hip, it also affected your shoulder, your whole left side. That's why you're feeling the burning on the left side of your body. Actually, you're being touched by the angel. It's burning right now in Jesus' name. I see a surgical scar that has not healed correctly. It has been very painful. It has, hasn't it? It's been very, it got herniated. Is that correct? And it's created esophagus issues. and reflux. The Lord is ministering to you right now in Jesus' name. Your eyesight is beginning, I'm seeing now from left to right, your eyesight is beginning to be affected a little bit. Your peripheral vision. I see something floating. Does that make sense to you? Something floating?
Yes.
Floaters? Okay. Your peripheral vision is being affected. Particularly your right eye right now in Jesus' name. It's burning, isn't it? See, your right eye is getting touched right now because if it doesn't get corrected, you'll have a cataract. And you banged your head at another time on this side, this area here, and this part right here. And it really affected, it created like a ringing and in your ear and affected this whole area. You're being set free. So I'm believing God's giving you brand new legs, brand new circulation, brand new, your blood. Needs to be thinned. You need more oxygen in your body. This is the problem. It affects you at night. You've got to get up quite often, at least 6 times a night. It's very difficult for you to do so. And most of the time, you don't sleep in the bed, but you go down or you go into your other room. I see a big, nice, comfortable chair there, right? Cushions. Afghan of some sort that some member of your family made. That's about 32 years old. That keeps you warm, and that one of your dogs, the scruffy looking one, all right? The mutt. Kind of medium size, kind of grayish black. Lord Jesus, liberator. No. Just, no, really, liberator. I don't mean from the dogs. I just, in Jesus' name. That's panorama. Now, if you got 54 different things wrong with you, I don't have time. Just receive it. Hallelujah. It's an anointing for all of it. Watch the difference. Give the Lord the praise, the glory, the honor. Poke her. Seemed like an MRI going from your head. Let's, is there a way we can have these children? I understand, but it needs to be a little bit more. We can fellowship. Because I have to really concentrate. I mean, the kids can come in. I mean, I'm not all freaked out, you know, that children can't be playing and talking, but just not running around and stuff, you know. See an MRI, you know what an MRI is? See, I actually see like a machine. It goes down and goes down and goes down and goes down. It goes down and goes down. It's going down. It's going down. And the lower part of your back is being touched right now. I see vertebras and discs in the lower part of your back that are completely disintegrated. You live in constant excruciating pain. You're such a woman of faith. And it's amazing, you see other people healed, and you've got this great prophetic word, and it's just, it's amazing the discernment you have. You know, you ought to be praying for me. I mean, just the years of experience. I tell you, you're just like, I'm mom, hallelujah. This is mama here. But one of the sons is going to minister to mama here, hallelujah. So would you please come here, because the Lord wants to minister to you so that you get healed. I know, help her up. Come on, Fozzie, do your job. She's been sitting too long. Well, that's going to have to change in Jesus' name. You may be African American. You're not, we're in Canada, but that's North America. But You know, yeah, you with your hands up, stand up right where you're at. How you doing there, dude? You ready? Come on up here.
He's African.
Huh? He's African? Figure that. You don't know. Let's bless this woman. That's right. Right in the lower part of your back. And that's so fun. You're so fun. You're so... Oh, I got to give you a hug. You are just so dear.
You know what?
Dear.
You're the same age as my son.
I'm the same age as your son. Is that a good age? Is that an old age? Or is that in my prime? Oh, thank you, hon. I sometimes don't feel it. I do. Hallelujah. Someone came up to me and said, pray that I live to be 120. I thought, you got a spirit of dumb on you. You want to be on this earth for 120 years? You don't have a revelation of heaven. I want to be out of here by 80, all right? That's just me. No, I'm not. Okay. You're only 69.
Oh, thank you.
Would you, sister, pastor, would you come here? Would you put your hands on her lower back? It's too quiet in here. I just thought I got transported to a real staunchy draw. No, anyway, hallelujah. Am I in a charismatic, catch the fire,
Yes. Feisty,
renewal? You're just watching. Some of you are in shock. Because you're used to, there's someone out there that's got a back pain. Word of knowledge. Well, if you sit any longer than 10 minutes in that chair, as wonderful those chairs are, how many of you got a back pain? I'm not minimizing those words of knowledge. I'm just saying this is what you're coming into. Isn't this wonderful? And I can only handle a few of these because the glory room is pretty heavy, isn't it? Sense it there? Oh, it's going to ruin you. Oh, wait. What's this jerky? Oh, I'm in a jerky church. Okay, all right. I keep forgetting. This is Airport Vineyard. All right, hallelujah. Catch the fire. So.
Catch the fire.
I love this ministry. Hallelujah. See, the burning is going right through your spine right now. There's particularly two that are trying to fuse.
Whoa.
And your disc has been ruptured right now in Jesus. You had a little slight fall.
Yeah.
Oh, yes, you did. See, this is what you get for having winners up here.
Exactly.
I see you slipping on the ice. Mm-hmm. Kind of going up a step. Lord Jesus, would you bless her? Let's touch her. Make her whole, Lord. Now, I'm sorry I'm not Jesus. It takes me a little longer. Loose! Don't you go down. You two are, you're fired. No. You have been worthless this whole time. I'm having fun with him. He's been wonderful. Oh, my God, sister. Andre, what are you? You from Africa?
From Nigeria.
Benin City?
Yes, Lagos.
That's what I meant, Lagos. I saw a big city. A lot of corruption in that city.
Yes, sir.
You going to see that corrected?
Yes, sir.
Yes, you are, aren't you?
Yes.
You will. Let's bless them right now in Jesus' name. Oh, she's snorting down there. Who's snorting? Is that your wife snorting? Is that the anointing? Oh. It's an oinking. An oinking anointing. God did a great miracle for you. open up a door which no man can close, to break a generational curse, okay, of corruption that brought people into great poverty. Okay? You're blessed. You know you are. But there's been mental harassment of the enemy. Not so much now, but it was at a period of time. You persevered. It was a depression because of what was said you couldn't do. And you persevered through that in Jesus' name. Amen. But I see something, you got to move to another level, and I see something again is trying to put a stronghold in your mind that you can't achieve that next level. It's a lie of the enemy. Now, lift off of him. And you're getting one of your knees touched. Yeah, right here. This whole side here. You ready? Is that correct? Hallelujah. It's too quiet in here. No, this is really bad. No, this is really bad. This isn't just a sore. I mean, this is, you got a whole tear all the way down from your hip. Yes. And, yeah, it's deteriorating. Your hip socket is deteriorating. And it's all the way down, and it affects your foot and your... Right, yeah, show me, yeah, right there. I'm pointing at it. I'm sorry. I'm going to reach down and touch those funky things. But it starts here. This is what happened. And this was because, ooh, come on, everyone, right now in Jesus' name. You were kind of athletic as a kid growing up.
Yeah.
That's correct. Is that right? In school?
Yeah.
College as well?
Yeah.
Soccer or whatever.
Yeah, play soccer, yeah.
You played soccer, that's what I'm seeing. And in a particular match, something happened that started this. And there was also an accident. But God's healing you right now because this is what you kicked. You kicked from this. This is your greater foot,
yeah.
Greater strength. Is that correct?
Yeah.
So I speak, there it is, right there. All of it's gone. In Jesus' name. Loose! Touch the, in his family, the various blood pressure issues. Okay? You know what I'm talking about.
Yes.
The cholesterol issue. But the blood pressure in particular, in Jesus' name.
Amen.
All right, well, let's see you move on that foot, that leg, that knee. Jump up and down. You won't tear your britches. Come on, how you doing? Is that a brand new leg and knee? There you go. Hallelujah. Give the Lord a praise offer. Amen. More. No, go ahead. Give me a hug. You're supposed to go back over there. Sit, that's your chair right there. She don't think she knows where she's at. I don't know where I'm at. It's kind of like, you know, I get caught up. Okay, we got it. Usually my meetings go to 2 to 3 in the morning. That's why I've had to limit from 350 to 400 services a year down to 200 in this operation. We're going to have some fun, okay? Come on, let's. I got to catch my. Just everybody worship Lord. I've got this thing's got to lift off of me right now. Hallelujah. Or lift on me or strengthen me or. Well, Let me pray for you. Sweetheart, come here. Let me pray for you. While the glory is here, while the angel is here. Hallelujah. Let's just reach our hands out. And this is for the sake of her husband. She's so precious. And so endearing to the Lord. And she's reaching out. Come on, let's just reach your hands to the Lord. And I just, my heart just, I've just wept in my spirit because I just, the most dearest person to her, the enemy's trying to take him out. And she's been such a warrior in it all and such a gracious woman. But with all of the weakness and fatigue that comes with it and the lack of sleep and all of that, we just want her to be refreshed. And this in turn moves, come on, let's pray for her husband, moves and liberates him because he has got incredible, I mean, does he have morphine drip? See, he's at that stage now where it's just too much pain. Is he in hospice?
Hospital.
Hospital, but it's like a hospice scenario or just in the hospital. Father, we want this man around. Yeah. Heaven doesn't need him yet. I don't mind if you take him home, but Father, I just want your will to be done for her sake. That right now, as he is laying in that bed right now in Jesus' name. Okay, now let it come right now. See, this is a deliverance need. This is a spirit of infirmity. I dissect it, discern it. I get several vibrations in my spirit, in my fingers that is a detection. I detect the movement of a spirit of infirmity. And it's been on her. It's been upon her husband. There's been sickness and one thing after another. One thing after another. But now it's acute. In Jesus' name, I command the spirit of infirmity and the spirit of familiarity that's been passed down to the third and fourth generation that feels it's got a trespass right to afflict her and her husband. I sever you from the spirit of familiarity and the spirit of infirmity. There it is. Right. Well, there it is. Right there in Jesus' name. The spirit already left. And now we're just believing the administration. See, that's the, you see, that's the fire. That's the fire. It's going right through your body. Directly to your husband. Right now in Jesus' name. I will rarely do this, but I know something. Can't tell you what, but I know there's something that's being imparted. There's a peace that's coming over his mind, a peace that's coming over his body. Come on, everybody, and just pray in the Holy Ghost. There's a peace that's coming over. His breathing is shallow right now. I speak that organ, that main major organ that has been attacked. What has been metastasized right now, every cell to be cursed, to die at the root. Right now, dematerialize, get flushed out of his body. We want this man to be free from pain. Jesus, you bore the pain. You carried the disease and the sickness. By your stripes, he is healed. Right now, I speak over this lady. And I speak to her. There it is, right there. Let it go. Right now, see, there's a lot of deliverance that's coming to your family. This thing has just been, you've been plagued. It's been in your home, oppression in your home. And this is no reflection on you. It's just you're an innocent victim. Right now in Jesus' name, come on, let's bless her right now. I just speak to every joint in your body to be healed. That's it. All the fatigue to leave your body right now in Jesus' name. For him to be made whole. I mean to be made whole. To be made whole. To be made whole. We've got to have some metal leave some people's bodies here tonight. just as a sign and wonder to make you wonder. Amen. So I want to minister to the person that has it in the leg area or foot area, knee area right now in Jesus' name. If you have metal in your body of any sort, would you stand right now in Jesus' name? And we're just going to believe God. Okay, I want the all of you are going to be ministered to. So I want the I don't know if you're African American or African Canadian or whatever. No, the other guy. What, you're fine. You don't have any metal in your body. Get your hands down. I just got done ministering to your knee. The other guy right here in the back, way in the back there, the big guy. Come here. We're going to start with you now. We're not going to forget anyone else here, okay? Just hang in there for a few moments. Okay, and I want the Asian young lady to come here because I'm being led of the Spirit here, okay? I mean, not that God doesn't love everyone. Just stand for just a few minutes here. Let me minister to him first, okay? How you doing? We're still under the glory of the angels here. Hallelujah. Whew, boy, did you get a whack in your body. You ready for an overhaul?
Yeah, good one.
How would you know you're healed when Jesus heals you? How would you know it? You wouldn't know?
Yeah, I'd know.
Well, how?
It's
a gift of faith. You're speaking it. You're making proclamation. You'd feel it where?
My knee, my back, shoulders, arms.
That's where all your metal's at?
No,
I know.
Yeah, you're good.
But, so do you feel the metal in your knee?
Yeah, sometimes. Yeah,
you do, don't you? Does it have like a bulge? Like a knot?
Sometimes, yeah.
No, it's okay. Tell me, yes or no?
Yeah.
It knots up, doesn't it?
Yeah.
It's on the side. I'm seeing in vision form right now. You should begin to sense a burning right now. It's too quiet in here. Just relax, rest. Don't try to believe. You fall short. It's not your faith anyway. It's the faith of the Lord that he gave you initially. You're just turning it back to him. But see, I'm moving in a sovereign seer realm. So right now, you should begin to sense something happen right now. You sensing anything yet? It is, isn't it? Don't know tiny bit. I don't do 50, 60, 70, 80% stuff. Well, that's okay. It's just I believe 100% healing right now in Jesus' name. Job related?
No, of course.
No, I knew. But I'm just saying. See, I'm not moving in panorama right now. But I am moving and creating miracles. Okay, now put your hand down there where your ankle, your knee is. Okay, metal leaves one or two ways. It liquefies, comes through the pores. That's how it comes out. We've seen 10,000. Okay, it should get sticky or just dematerializes. God changes the composition. I've actually watched it flake out on the carpet, so has everybody else. Now move your knee. Do you sense any difference?
It's hard to tell.
How are you going to know? Do you feel the metal in your knee?
No.
You don't? I mean, did you?
Yes, if I put my hands.
Put your hands down there. Do you feel any metal in that area? Because I don't see it. It's okay. If you do, you do. If you don't, you don't. Is it hard to tell?
Yeah.
Well, you're no fun.
I know.
Father, I speak a miracle of recreation right now. There it is. Touch him right now in Jesus. There, you feel it? There it goes. Something on your arm here. Loose them. Now put your hands there. What? Feels different, doesn't it? You feel the little bubble? It's like a little lump.
Yeah.
Is it gone?
Yeah.
It is, isn't it? Jump up and down. You won't tear your britches. Go grow some hair. Hallelujah. No. You may not believe it, but he was actually healed. I know by revelation. I wouldn't say that. Hey, are you going to be as boring as him?
No. I can feel it right here. I have a plate and a bowl.
What'd you do?
I had a bike accident.
Oh, a bike accident.
This side of my face is kind of paralyzed.
It is. So you have sort of a palsy thing because of the nerves that was hurt. Well, there's the fire. Feel it? There you go. You don't even have to try to believe. If you don't think you have the faith, I do. Just receive it. It's Jesus. Just envision his hand blending in mine. Remember that story? The Lord loves you as much as that young girl. There you go. Feels kind of funky, doesn't it? It's the only way I can describe it. Now, I want you to begin to touch it. Every time you do that, you're activating your faith. We're calling those things to be not as though they were, huh? It should be gone completely. Move around. Feel it. See if it's still there. Is it smaller? Is it different?
Yeah.
Oh, do I got to take more time? I'm sorry, I'm not Jesus. It's too quiet in here. Come here, sister in the blue. There you go. Now you're getting more of it. Oh, now, see, you shift it, it's shifting. See, you got to put, the metal's got to leave, so the bone, you're getting new bone. The bone is growing. The bone is growing, right? Now feel it. You may be feeling bone starting to come in.
Yeah, it's really different.
It's different, isn't it? It's a different composition, isn't it? Feel the other side, a little, your whole thing. See, it's different. See, it should feel the same as the other side. But that, is that your metal or your bone?
Do you feel it? Like,
yeah?
Feel it,
well, that to me feels the same. Go ahead, try it again.
Okay.
This isn't the fun. Quit it. I know what you're talking about. But what's happening is the bone from the backside is starting to come forward and pressing the metal out to the surface. That's why you're feeling it. I speak a miracle of recreation right now in Jesus' name. Right now in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Oh, this is fun. Now I want you to feel it. Composition has changed?
It's so different.
It's different, isn't it? Isn't that cool?
It feels like bone.
It's bone. That's not metal. That's a bone like on the other side. This is what workings of miracles means. You're working with them. That was deep revelation, wasn't it? I'll teach on that sometime. Come here, sweetie. What happened?
I was in a car accident and ball of my hip pushed through the socket.
Ew. Do you have a metal hip there?
No, just rebuilt the socket.
Yeah. So how would you know you healed when Jesus heals you?
I don't know because I don't feel it.
You don't feel it?
Sorry.
No, it's okay. Put your hand on the area of your hip. Where your wife's, come here. Come here, put your hands on her left hip. Right now, I speak a miracle of recreation right now. You should, there's the shift. Right now, in Jesus' name. Come here, young man. Right now, in Jesus, it's too quiet in here. How's your nose doing there? That's a bone. Isn't that cool? Loose. Okay. Well, how would you know you're healed? Quickly. You don't know. Go sit down. All right. No, you precious. You be healed. Okay. I got to have something more exciting here. Not yet. Yeah, quickly, get up here. Come on up here, sweetheart. Come on up here. It's okay. Come on up here, Amber. Come on. You're so precious. Such a great woman of God. You ready for an overhaul?
Yes.
You're so great. I like her. She needs every bone joint in her body. Your porous, and I see in your bones. Yeah. Did you have some fuse? Did you have surgery here in your back?
No, I fell on my back and I tore the cortical
disc before I started. Yeah, well, I want this sister to come up here.
Something scoliosis. Okay.
It's not good. Well, you're ready to get healed? Of course not. In Jesus' name. You're ready to be healed. In Jesus' name. Ooh, there's the fire. Isn't that fun? Aren't you a little live wire? You're a little spark plug. I like you.
I did like this when they did the diagnosis. So they spoke, they whispered only, and they did like this with their hands. And I said, I'm expecting a divine
intervention. Great. Yeah, you're talking too much. Hallelujah. Yes, what's the matter? Well, that's not metal in your body, is it? No, it's just, why are you sore? We'll deal with these in a little bit. But you're getting healed before everyone else. Isn't that fun? Because the Lord called you out right there in Jesus' name. What's the word? Fibro. That's what I see. It's an inflammation and a weakness within your body. In Jesus' name. I see as a child around 2 to 3 years of age, you had a very severe fever. And it affected, you won't even remember, but it affected your body. No! In Jesus' name, it broke off of you. Yes. You made my hand burn. Those are burns. I actually get sometimes first-degree burns that have to be treated. How you doing, dude?
Hello.
What you need?
I'm wondering, you said metal, right?
Yeah?
Metal in my mouth.
What's that mean?
I have metal in my mouth from jaw surgery.
Oh. What's wrong with metal in your mouth? I got metal in my mouth. Is it teeth metal?
Yeah.
Is it bothering you? Oh, sit down. Hallelujah. Come here, sir. Receive it. Hallelujah. Y'all are so patient. Just, you know, these are so sedate. We got to. You're Canadian. Oh, is that what it is? Well, I never thought that about Canadians. I'll tell you what happened. I was up in Abbotsford. No, what's next to Abbotsford? Richmond? No, right next to it. Lancaster. Langley. And a baby had no brain in the mother's womb. She was miscarrying in the service because the baby just had the stem, and God, overnight, when they went and checked the next morning, gave the baby a brand new brain. You know, that was in Canada. And everybody got real excited. How you doing? Are you an important man? Does that mean you're important?
Just a watch.
Just a watch. You ready for the Lord to overhaul you?
Sure.
You have metal in your body?
Yeah, it's in my ankle, lower leg area.
What? Riding a bike?
I can't feel it.
You can't feel it. I'm not going to reach down. I'm too lazy. Where's Fosse?
Right here.
Fosse, go down there. Boston, go down there. Everybody just bless. I want to pray for the lady in the red right here. Your, no, just right where you're at. What's your nationality? Are you Indian, Pakistani? West Indian. I want to minister to you right now in Jesus' name. Let's reach your hands up to her right now. See the whole, I see a band around your whole head area. It starts there in your neck area, goes down your spine, but particularly in this area here. I'm believing the Lord to really minister to you right now in Jesus' name. Any types of headaches, any types of pressure in that area in Jesus' name. See the back of your eyes like a pressure right now in Jesus' name. The Lord is making you whole. Right now, receive it in Jesus' name. You've been burdened for a young lady. I'm believing that the Lord is intervening, interceding, your family members, particularly. Right now, in Jesus' name, touch those people. Minister to them. Their hearts are being softened very powerfully. You've sown seed, the word that you've sown will not return unto the Lord void. In Jesus' name. How you doing? Now move your ankle. Any feeling coming back? Give it a minute. Exercise your faith. Any feeling yet? Because you've had severed nerves. Terribly. My, my, my. Yeah, it is. There it is. I'm seeing it in the spirit. It's a gift of faith. You don't even have to try to believe. It's a gift of faith that's giving you the faith to believe. See, it's not just proclamation. It's demonstration. You're just activating your faith. You're saying, Lord, I'm just accepting it right now in the now. So see, your miracle is going to cause you to see a lot of people healed, and a lot of people are going to receive it too. Reach down one more time. You better be anointed. Because if he isn't healed, it's your fault. Hallelujah. No. Father, I'm teasing, man. Father, I just speak a miracle of healing right now in Jesus' name. Get it, dude? You got metal in that area? Do you? Yeah, I see that. Do you feel the pin?
No.
You never can feel the pin?
No.
It's so deep. You never feel the screws? Yeah, but move it right now, because life, you should begin to sense a pricking, a tingling starting to come back into that area. You have nerve damage was severed. The nerves are black. They're becoming enriched red. See, it was just dead. Your foot died. I mean, it's got circulation, but I mean, just saying the usage of it. This thing's happening right now in Jesus' name. Where's my stool? My seat. Hurry, hurry, hurry. Come on, South African, run. No, this is all right. I'm lazy. I want a ministry team person. Just stand right over here and just continue to minister to him for just a few more moments because he's going to get a breakthrough. Those that are still standing, you can come to my right, and I'm going to take for the next 35 minutes. If I were you, if you want prayer for healing, I'd run, hallelujah, and just come to the right side, your left. And that means everybody. Now, obviously, I'm not going to get to everybody here tonight, so don't be offended. In a few moments, okay? Just give me about 10 minutes. Just put her to the side just for a few moments. Let me feel. You don't have to take her anywhere, but just put her right there. Let me just get into the operation. Now, everybody stay out of the way so people can see. And you just come to my side. Come here, sweetie. I'm going to move in discernment now. This is Gifts of Healings and Workings of Miracles. Turn it aside. Now, just tell me what's wrong. You ready to get healed? Now, I need a sister to work with me to put her hand upon her tummy, anyone of the ministry team. Okay, yield right there. There it is. There's somebody there that, don't stand. You guys are in the way. Get over so everybody can see. But get right behind her in case she's overwhelmed. Most won't. I'm not concerned if they fall or not. There you go. Oh, your thyroid is just gone, basically. Did you know that? It's just gone. Huh? There it goes. Now you're getting it. You feel it? Oh, I feel it. Like a lump. Now put your finger there and you ought to be, put your finger where your thyroid wasn't there. You had like an empty sack there. There you go. You feel that thyroid? You got a brand new thyroid. Wasn't there. You feel it? Yeah. All right, you got to go that way. No, no worship.